awesome was that? Woo! Yes, sir. Oh, man, that's so good. Very excited to be here. And welcome to Central. We are honestly so pumped that you guys have decided to come here today. We want to give a special welcome to our new guest today. Maybe this is your first time here. We actually would love to get to know you a little better. And so if you wouldn't mind taking a few moments, directly in the seat in front of you, there's a card. It says, how can we connect with you? And simply grab that card, take a moment to fill it out, and immediately following the service, you can take that card into the lobby. There's a big blue wall. Simply give it to one of the smiling faces, and we would love to find out how we can serve you even better. We would actually love to exchange that card and give you a gift just for coming today. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We are so excited that you guys have decided, and for all of us, just for coming here on a Sunday morning, we thank you so much for coming to Central today. At this time, I'd like to call our hosts forward for our tithes and offerings. And if you're new, again, we just want to let you know, please feel no obligation to give today. But if you did come ready to give, we just want to remind you there are three options, three ways that you can give today. In just a moment, we're going to be passing around a basket. You can put your donation in there. We also have a number of kiosks in the lobby that accept debit or credit. And the third option is you can go online at centralcc.ca/give. And so if you wouldn't mind using one of those options, that would be absolutely wonderful. Now, how many of you know what is happening in 6 weeks as of today? Anyone? Anyone? Christmas is coming! Yeah! So excited. How many of you have your lights and your tree already up? All right? Please, let's not be envious, okay? It is not even December yet. Okay, people? Which means we're very excited. I love Christmas, as probably most of you do as well. And that also means that in 6 weeks, we have our amazing, unbelievable Christmas Eve services. How many of you have been part of those services in the past? It is honestly one of the greatest things that we do. It is a great opportunity for you to bring family, friends, to come yourself. It is honestly amazing. And we have five opportunities that you can take part of. We have two services on December 23rd at 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock, and then three services on December 24th at 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock, and 7 o'clock. Now, if you have children under the age of 5, we do provide childcare for the first four opportunities. It's a great time for you to just come as a family. Now, it is very kid-friendly, and so we encourage you, if you have older kids, bring them along. It's such a great, great time. But please, do not come alone. This is an unforgettable experience, and once again, it is going to be amazing. Bring your family, bring your friends, even now. I know it's 6 weeks away, but just begin to think about who you can invite to be able to come to an experience like that. Well, at this time, I'd love to call Pastor Bill up to the stage to continue our series called Mastermind. And if you missed week number one, check out the screen behind me.
Anger, in the appropriate context, is actually love in action. Something is wrong, you recognize it, it stirs an emotion, we call that anger, and it actually propels you to action, but it's driven by love. See, the Bible says in Ephesians 4:26, be angry and do not sin. Be angry. The Bible actually says, be angry, but do not sin. So where's that line? And the line is where your love is directed. What are you angry about? Have you ever stopped to just say, God, can you show me why? What is it? What in me is broken? And here's the deal. You can't do this on your own. You need God's help. If you humble yourself, the Bible says God will lift you up. Well, good morning. How's everybody doing? Are you good? All right. Hey, thank you so much for being here. And if you're watching online from wherever you are around the world, thank you so much. And just so you know, if you have any questions, you can use access the chat box right next to you. Talk to one another. Have a great time. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you for being here live as well, as we are in the second week of what I think is going to be a liberating experience for many of us, as we talk about emotions. And last week, we talked pretty candidly about anger, my anger specifically, and we learned that anger actually is a God-given emotion if it's directed to protect those you love. And so we learned that you can be angry, but do not sin. And so today, we're going to talk about depression. So if you're a Maple Leaf fan, you're in the perfect spot. That went over better in the first service. No, we're just kidding. This is actually a really serious conversation, and we are seeing in our culture today, especially in North America, an increase in anxiety and depression. And so we want to unpack it. What is it? And how could that possibly be good? And if you find yourself today anxious or depressed, how can you find the way out? And I just believe today that wherever you're watching, whether online or here today, that God actually wants to do something in your life, that today is a crossroads experience for many of you to find your way out of the anxiety and depression that you are battling. Well, this whole series is rooted really in a passage of Scripture found in the Bible in a book called 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. And in this, we've learned that emotions really are an internal battle, a battle in the mind, and we need to learn to navigate them. So the author Paul writes to us, encouraging us to demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. What we're going to learn today is that there's a battle between truth, and we believe God is truth, the source of truth and all truth, and lies. And so there is these things that battle against that truth. And we take captive, it's an act of the will, every thought to make it obedient to Christ. We're going to find that the way out isn't a 10-step process, it's a person. And the way out is Jesus. So let me ask you a question. Have you ever had a bad day? Yeah, of course you have. Has that bad day ever turned into a bad week? Yeah, sometimes. Maybe that week turned into a really bad month, a bad year. How about a bad life? Are you here today, and if you're honest, how you feel, despite your circumstance, you just feel like everything always goes wrong. You feel like everything is against you. You feel like you'll never find your freedom. Chances are, if you're here and you've lost hope, you may be battling depression. Or if you're here and you're stressed out about something, maybe you're stressed out about how you're going to pay your bills. You're stressed out about tomorrow. You got to go to work and deal with that situation. Or after this, you got to go home and deal with that person. And you're anxious about it. You're losing sleep. Perhaps you need to hear what God wants to say to you today. And sometimes we feel bad, and the reasons are pretty obvious. Maybe you've had a bad circumstance, a situation, a loss. Maybe you've lost a job, or you've lost a friendship, or you've lost a loved one to death. And so these are obvious reasons why we feel deep, deep sorrow. But sometimes you can't even explain it. You just feel off, right? You can't articulate it in words, and there's no particular situation. You just feel like things aren't the way they're supposed to be. And so maybe you're here and you're battling something. I went on to the National Institute of Mental Health because I wanted to understand depression and anxiety, and I wanted to see some of the symptoms. So I have a list here. Just to kind of help you begin to identify, maybe you're wrestling with something here. And so you have difficulty concentrating. Thank you. Remembering details, like your kids' names, and making decisions. Maybe you're here and you have an increase in fatigue, or you have decreased energy. Maybe you're here and you're battling feelings of great guilt or worthlessness and or helplessness. Maybe you're here, you're feeling hopeless or pessimistic. It's hard not to when you watch the news. Maybe you're here and you're suffering from insomnia, or you're waking up early in the morning, or you're excessively sleeping. Maybe you're irritable and you have restlessness. Maybe you have lost interest in activities and hobbies that once were really pleasurable. Maybe you're overeating, or you've lost your appetite. Persistent aches or pains or headaches or cramps or digestive problems that do not ease even with treatment. Maybe you're persistently sad or anxious or have empty feelings. Or maybe you even have thoughts of suicide. Maybe you've even attempted suicide. These could be signs that you are depressed. And so here's what I believe God wants us to learn today. What good emotion could possibly tie to depression and anxiety? And I believe that there is a good emotion, and the emotion is sorrow. I think grief and sorrow are a natural part of the reality that we live in a broken world. And so all of us feel sorrow. All of us feel grief. When someone dies, we should feel sad. When we lose something that we loved and valued, we should feel sad. So what's the line between sadness and depression? If we could identify that, and what is the way out? You see, I think the line is, when we feel sad, it's like we learned last week. Emotions are like warnings on a dashboard. So you're driving along the road, and you know your flashlight, your seatbelt says fasten your seatbelt, light flashes, and you don't acknowledge it, you ignore it, you get in an accident, you get hurt, because you ignored the warning sign. The warning sign isn't the problem, it's the symptom. It's something much deeper. And so when we find ourselves in a place of sorrow or sadness or grief, that's okay as long as we know why we're feeling that and we know the way out. And here's what we're learning. Psychiatrists and health journalists, I read all kinds of articles this week, a ton of them, identify that North Americans are more anxious and depressed, recorded or at least acknowledged, than anywhere else in the world. Why is this? And I believe it's because our emotions are tied too much to our circumstance. And there's a couple of reasons for that. We, for the first time in history, have incredible affluence. Now, I know, you're saying, not me. Actually, if you're to study history, most of us in this room, most of you watching online, live better than kings in past history. So the problem with affluence comes the problem of comparison. When you have more than you need, then you begin comparing what you have to what other people have, and you believe you need what they have. And so you don't value what you have, you begin to grieve what you lack. And so a lot of anxiety and depression is this constant pursuit of things that you think you need. So you're working more than you should, you're stressing out about things more than you should, because you've put yourself in a position of comparison with temporary things. So we live in this dilemma. And so a lot of our grief is attached to what we don't have instead of celebrating what we do have. We also expect too much. We live in the multimedia age, and so in the movies, it always works out, right? In the movies, it doesn't matter how bad it gets, there's always a happy ending. Well, most of the times, except in the really dark ones. But most movies, right, we love them because the hero wins. And so we expect that should happen in our life. So maybe you're sitting around waiting for the win, and you've defined your win as some circumstance or situation. And so when it doesn't work out, you think you should be happy, but you're not. This is our challenge in North America. The challenge is our disordered sorrow. It's sorrow rooted in the wrong thing. A lot of our sorrow, our grief, our anxiety, our depression is rooted in circumstances that cannot be trusted. It's possible the economy could crash. So if your joy, your happiness isn't rooted in how much money you make, what happens when you lose your job? When your joy or your happiness is rooted in another person who isn't perfect and they fail you, what happens to your joy and your happiness? When your joy and your happiness is rooted to your physical health, what happens when you get sick? See, the problem isn't feeling sorrow. The problem is rooting your sorrow in things that are temporary rather than things that are eternal. So here's what we're going to learn today. Two things you need to know about depression. The first is, depression is not a sin. I think if you grew up in a church culture, the belief or the lie is that you're supposed to feel happy all the time. And if you don't feel happy, there's something wrong with you. You don't have enough faith. You don't believe enough. So we say things and we mean well, but they don't work. We say things like, just suck it up. Just be happy. Think about all the good things. But that's like putting water on a gas fire. It just spreads it. Because it's not like the person is trying not to be happy. Nobody wants to be depressed. So when you come and say, stop being depressed, they go, I don't know how, and they feel more depressed. The truth is that in the Bible, there were people who got depressed. King David, who wrote the book of Psalms, remember we talked about this great book of songs? in one of the Psalms, he says, I am so in so much anguish that I feel like my bones are literally being crushed. That's depression. There's a prophet, Elijah, a hero of the faith. One day he crawls under a tree after a circumstance I'm going to preach on one day because it's awesome, but the situation, not this. But he crawls under this tree and he looks to heaven and he says, God, just kill me. He's suicidal. So the challenge, the problem isn't with your thoughts, it's what you do with those thoughts. That's the issue we want to address today. And to feel sorrow and grief is normal. It's natural. It's a warning that something isn't right. But if you can't address the real wrong, the wrong that's deep inside of you, if you believe the lie that if I just change my external circumstance, I'm going to be happy, you're deceived. You're going to build a prison for yourself that you will never get out of. And so the Bible reminds us that actually this is a spiritual battle. Now, I don't know what you believe about God, but I can tell you what I believe and what we believe as a church family and what we believe the Bible teaches. We believe that there is truth, but truth is not an idea, it's not a philosophy, it's a being, it's God himself. God is truth. And we also believe that there's an enemy against truth. The Bible calls him the devil or Satan or Lucifer, and he is the father of lies. So when it comes to anxiety and depression, here's the simple truth. It is a spiritual battle for what you believe about your circumstance. Ephesians 6 says, our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness in the spiritual realm. Here's what happens. In the ancient world, war was very common. We think, oh man, war's increasing. No, there's always been war. And in the ancient world, sometimes if a king wanted to spare a lot of innocent lives or lives of his soldiers, he would propose to the other king that there be a battle of champions. Okay, if you grew up in Sunday school, it's the classic story of David and Goliath. So one side would pick their champion, in the case of the Philistines, Goliath, this monstrous man. And the other side would pick their champion. In this case, everyone was too scared, so they picked a little shepherd boy, David, to go fight him. Not a good choice in the natural. And these two enemies, these two champions would face each other, and whoever won that confrontation would dictate the destiny of a nation. If Goliath wins, the Philistines control Israel. If David wins, the Israelites control Philistia. This was the battle. And this is the battle that you and I go through every day when it comes to anxiety and depression. There is a lie that sneaks into your head that says all kinds of things like, you're worthless, you're useless, you're stupid, you'll never amount to anything, you're never going to be free from this, everybody hates you. This is the lie of the enemy. And it torments you so much that sometimes you let it win. And when you let it win repeatedly, it actually begins to dictate not only what you believe, but how you behave. And so anxiety and depression is rooted in a lie. And if that lie is allowed to dominate, it will build a prison and put you in it. And it is dark. And there are some of you watching online and sitting here today who actually believe that there's no way out of this prison. Maybe it's because you've been in it for so long, or maybe the lie is just so big that you don't think you'll ever be free. And so you've lost hope. That's depression, when you've lost hope. And then people take their lives, not because they're bad people, but because they don't see any way out, and they would rather escape this life than have to endure this life. And so the giant is massive. Goliath, he's huge. And this little shepherd boy named David, with no armor, no weapons but a sling and a stick, comes to this giant, and this giant looks at him and mocks him. And maybe you feel like every day you are mocked. Every day you wake up and you look in the mirror, you are mocked. Every day you walk to work or in that relationship, you are mocked, beat down, depressed, discouraged. And so the giant mocks David and says, what am I, a dog, that you come at me with sticks and stones? What do you think this is? Do you not see me? How great I am, how mighty I am. You will never defeat me. And this little shepherd boy says something incredibly profound. He says, you come at me with all kinds of weapons, but I have got a power source and a weapon greater than anything you can hurl at me. I come in the name of the Lord. I come in truth. And here's the truth, Goliath. God is greater than you, my situation. God is greater than every lie that has come out of your mouth. God is greater than anything you think you've got against me. God is greater. He believed it. And the Bible reminds us that when we trust in God, for in the ancient world, this wasn't a battle between human beings, it was a battle between the gods. David believed the truth in his situation, even though it was daunting and intimidating, and everyone else around him, even his brothers, were cowarding, hiding in cowardice behind him. He stood in a truth that God gives me victory. And so I don't know what situation you find yourself in. I don't know what lie you have begun to believe, but I need to tell you the truth. That it's a battle in your mind, and there is a way out, and the way out isn't a process, it's a person, and his name is Jesus. And he knew that you would forget who you were, so he stepped into this world to remind you that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. He stepped into this world to remind you that there's a God who made you with purpose and destiny, a God who does not define you by your mistakes or by what other people say about you, a God who is not limited by the giants of circumstance, but a God who is greater than all things and works all things together for good to those who trust him. This is the power that is available to you today if you will believe. And so there is a door on this prison. And he declared it this way. He said, I am the way out. I am the truth that will shatter that lie. I am the life you've been looking for. And his name was Jesus. And I don't want you just to hear it from me. I actually want you to hear a couple of stories today. And the first story is a great friend of mine. She's been a part of our church family for all of her life. And so I want you to welcome to the stage Ingrid D'Ortona. Would you welcome her this morning?
Awesome. Thank you.
So this week, and this is the way God works. When you start seeing him, you see him in everything. And so Ingrid sent me an email this week, and I just said, you got to tell this story. It's so good. And so, you know, Ingrid, you know, when people who know you and love you go, wow, you know, you have it all together. You know, how could you possibly be depressed? So just explain to us, tell us a bit of the story, how you got to that place of deep depression.
Well, I struggled with depression for about, on and off, for about 4 years. I thought at the time that it was probably due to my circumstances. Now, looking back, I know for sure that it was just the battle going on in my mind, like you talked about. It was my thought life. I was so focused on me and what I was lacking. I was just always envious of others and ungrateful for the things that I had, and just always thought others had it better than me, and just how bad my life was. Woe is me, this self-pity party that I was having. And so I was just wallowing in that, and just really anything else that the enemy was throwing at me, I was just feeding on it and meditating on it. And as a result, my life was just drudgery. I felt there was no joy in anything. I felt this hopelessness, and tasks that I was doing just seemed meaningless and pointless. There was just no hope or joy in life.
So how did you come to this awareness that, boy, this isn't the way it's supposed to be?
Well, it was just actually an encounter that I had here at the church that made me really realize the hold that this had on me. I hadn't I just knew that I was experiencing this, but didn't know at the time that it was my thoughts that were taking me there. Like I said, I thought it was my circumstances. But I came to church one night, and the speaker there just asked all those that were experiencing depression to come up to the front. And when she did that, there was just a flock of people that came up to the front. And she just prayed over everybody. And in that moment, I was totally transformed on the inside. I experienced joy like I have never experienced before. And it just switched, like a night and day experience in that moment. And I went home just completely filled with joy. And the whole next day was just an ordinary Monday. But I had such joy as I was walking around the house and just feeling so liberated. And I was just dancing and singing and just had such a joy that I never, ever experienced in my life ever before.
So what was the difference? So how did you get that? Like, what was that? Yeah, you can celebrate that. That's okay. If you'd explain to somebody, like, because they're going, oh, that's awesome. What was it? What switched?
Well, I believe that that prayer that she prayed over me just took hold of the enemy that was trying to fight for my life, and he took that authority over the enemy on my behalf. Mm. But the interesting thing was is that it didn't end there. Mm. The very next day, I would have to say that Monday, if you asked me what the best day of my life was, Monday that I was set free from depression, that was the best day of my life. But the problem was that Tuesday, that depression came back. Mm. And it came back worse than ever before. That was the worst day of my life. And I was crying from the moment I woke up. I couldn't even function. I was stumbling through the house. I was sobbing uncontrollably. I was bent over. I couldn't stand upright because of the intensity of the depression on me. And I was very weak. And I just remember having to, in my heart, I just knew that I needed to say the name of Jesus, but I would open my mouth and nothing would come out. And so I knew that there was something stopping me. So there was this spiritual battle happening, and something was stopping me from saying the name of Jesus. So I was carrying on through my day in the same way, just sobbing and sobbing. And finally, by midday, I just knew I had to say the name of Jesus. And I remember grabbing hold of the railing in our living room just so that I had some strength. And I just remember I needed to say that name. So I started, and little by little, I started to get his name off of my lips, letter by letter. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And every time I said it, I got stronger and stronger. And then I began to declare that I am a child of God covered in the shed blood of Jesus. I am a child of God covered in the shed blood of Jesus. And I didn't even know what I was really saying fully at that time, but those were the words that just came to me. And as I said those words, I knew that I was free. There was just this rest and this peace.
Yeah.
It did. It just totally took over me, and I just knew that the battle was won that day for good.
Yeah, and for those who may not be familiar with that phrase, the shed blood of Jesus, for us that's a reference to the cross. And the interesting thing about the Bible is it says that on the cross, all of our situation, all of our circumstance, all of our pain was placed upon him. It was the ultimate battlefield. And in this battle, it looked like he had lost. It looked like he was dead. But on the third day, he rose again. And so there's victory in that blood. And so that rally cry for us is the war cry. It was a shift of belief that this situation or circumstance is going to crush me, to know I serve a God who is greater than the circumstance. And that belief empowered you. And so really, when you think about it from a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, circumstances don't change that much, which proves that it really was an internal spiritual battle.
Right.
And you found freedom. So how do you navigate today? Like, Are you completely free from these thoughts now?
Well, that experience did really equip me for what I needed for other battles that came along on my way. Just knowing the power that there was in saying those words, saying the name of Jesus, and that took authority over the enemy in my life. It was like that same power that raised Christ from the dead now lives in me, and I have authority over the enemy as well. And the Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. And that's exactly what I was doing, even without fully realizing what I was saying. So that experience really equipped me for other battles. And just the power of speaking that out loud was huge. And also, I would say applying scripture to my life has been so huge in not only my spiritual health, but my mental health, my emotional health, my physical health, and even my relational health. You talked about that scripture verse that says to take your thoughts captive, and that verse was huge in my physical and emotional healing and mental healing. As I would apply that verse to my life, it made me aware of all the negative thoughts that were running through my head, which I wasn't aware of before. And it helped me to bring them to light and to actually look at them and pass them through the checklist that is in Philippians that says we are to think about things that are noble, that are true, that are pure, that are lovely, excellent, praiseworthy. These are the kinds of things we're supposed to be thinking about. And so I would pass my thoughts up, you know, put it up to that checklist. And if they didn't pass the list, then I had to learn to dismiss those ones and not meditate on those thoughts. And that is what has brought me so much healing inside. Like, I have been set free from anxiety, from self-hatred, and from fear just by applying that one verse to my life, by taking my thoughts captive.
Isn't that awesome? Would you just celebrate with me? That was thank you. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
That's awesome. Preach it. All right. That's awesome. That's what you needed to hear. You say, it can't be that easy. Yeah, actually it is. Because when you're powerless, he is powerful. There's this great story in the Bible where Paul, who writes 2/3 of what we call our New Testament, he has what he calls this thorn in the flesh, and he asks God, could you please take it away? And the answer he gets isn't the one that he wants. The answer that he gets is that my grace is sufficient for you, that in your weakness I am made strong. And so you see it as a limitation. You see it as a giant that's going to destroy you. God sees it as a lie that he is going to crush. And not only that, it's going to inspire others around you. For when David defeated that giant called Goliath, Israel suddenly got really brave and chased the Philistines away out of their land. So maybe you're here today and you're being tormented. You're being tormented by anxious thoughts in the middle of the night. You're being tormented by dark thoughts that you know come from somewhere else because you want to be happy. Maybe you are here and you're tormented by what you see in the mirror or the voices that are rattling around in your head. And I know it's a battle because right now you're fighting it. Right now I know it because whether you're watching online or you're here, some of you are already thinking, oh no, she doesn't know what she's talking about. That's not true. That can't happen for you. Those are the lies. The enemy rears up its ugly head and stands with great bravado in your face to destroy you. But you need to know that there is a way out. And his name is Jesus. And that's why we take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ, to him. If it doesn't stand up to what this says about me and about God and about life, I dismiss it. And so when I'm tempted to feel like I'm worthless, and I do too, I remind myself that God says I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. And when I'm tempted to think that I can't do this, this is too big for me, I'm reminded I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And when I'm tempted to feel like I'm a failure, that my mistakes define me, I'm reminded that Christ heals me and restores me, and he sets me on high places. He establishes my feet. And this is the reality of this powerful truth. For us, this is more than just a philosophy or an idea, positive thinking. This is rooted in a power source that created all things and created you for purpose and destiny. And so if you're here today and you need to find your way out of anxiety and depression, I want you to know something. You are not helpless. There is a helper who is willing to step into your life. And regardless of what you believe, there is a God who loves you and wants to champion you and fight for you and wants to help you find your way out. That's why he said in Matthew 11, 28, Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Just like a parent in the middle of a storm doesn't change the storm, their presence simply brings comfort because you know it's going to be okay. The God we serve promises that all things work together for good. And I actually believe it. I believe it. And so when situations get difficult, I lean into him more deeply. And then you can reclaim your purpose. The purpose that God has for you. And so the Bible says in Romans 8:38, "I am convinced that there is nothing that can separate me from the love of Christ. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers." There's nothing, no giant in your life that is greater than God's power and ability to deliver you. So if it's a physical giant, a financial giant, a relational giant, and you believe the lie that it's greater than you, you need to know there's a God who's greater than it and will defeat it. In John 16:33, Jesus said it this way, the best. He said, "I've told you these things, everything you've heard today, so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world."
I remember the day I left, and I knew when I was leaving, I was going to be a changed person. My father's family was dysfunctional, and he grew up in a very violent family. One little thing would spark off animosity or anger in the home, and I know it's affected all our family. I became so fearful of my father that's all I ever knew. And I remember my father telling me at 5 years old or 6 years old that I was stupid, and those words resonated with me. When my father came, he ruled, and he ruled with an iron fist in our family. So I had no point of reference because I felt like when I was at home, there was trouble. I always believed that when I got something good, something bad was gonna happen. My father never showed me what love was. I had to make love up. I had to go out into the community and find love. So it was very difficult growing up. It was very difficult trying to get some traction and understanding about life. When I played soccer and I didn't play soccer well, I didn't have anybody to tell me it was okay. I didn't have anybody watching me. And it's not a pity thing. It's just that we didn't have that love. And love is everything. It was strange because I thought leaving Canada, my father dying in 1978, that the fear would leave. I would leave that all behind in Belfast, but it didn't. My character followed me. Everything that I thought I left behind had followed me, and it took me into panic attacks, and I started to feel depressed. And I came home, and my family was in the kitchen, and I just sort of fell to my knees and I cried, and I said I couldn't do this no more. I just couldn't do it. And everything that I brought, everything I thought I escaped from, just followed me. And then starting to accept that maybe this is just as good as it's going to get for me. It can't get any better than this because I've tried a different country. I've got a wife. I messed it up, right? I've got kids. And I believed at one point that I wasn't as good a father as I should have been or should be. And getting a job at Ford and the pressures of working at at an assembly plant that size, I think that was the final straw that broke the camel's back. So at that point, I just asked God. I said, "God, if you are you are. If you're real, then show yourself to me. And I never thought anything of it. I was angry at the time. I just wanted God to show up. And then through 2006, as I said, I started traveling up and down the highway and I seen this cross. It was illuminated in the morning and it says, God loves you. And I'd go there and I'd start talking to God, praying, God help me, and God this and God that. And I just started seeing it every day. It was just over a period of 4 or 5 years. And Jacqueline and I started asking questions. Jacqueline was looking for a church. She was looking, she was searching, she was asking questions. And when she seen this service, she realized that that's exactly what she wanted in her Christian walk. So I was away with Ford and she'd called me at the hotel and she said, I found it. And I didn't know what she'd lost, but she'd find something, right? So she'd find Central Church. And she was so excited, so excited. So then she says she's going to church. And I said, okay, I'm not going. And she said, well, I'm going. So went reluctantly into Central. And of course I was pleasantly surprised with the welcoming committee. And then I get into the service and the lights went down and Bill was talking. And it was like the whole auditorium went silent. And I felt like there was one light that shone directly on me, and Bill looked at me and he said, you're not stupid. And it just resonated through me. I felt like 700 or 800 people in the auditorium had left and Bill was only just talking to me. And those words resonated in me. I couldn't stop thinking about, I'm not stupid. Then I realized that people were transparent, people were honest, people really, truly cared, right? And that's what I got from Central, was that caring, that loving, nurturing, it's okay to open up. And from that, the church, the way it was, really accelerated my faith. And I know that he's there, I know he understands, and I know that everything I consider to be bad in my life, he's starting to use for good, because the fear is starting to peel off. The anger has left me, the depression has left me, and I'm just rising up, and I know that God has made me wonderful, wonderfully made person, and I'm not who the world has defined me to be. I am who God says I am, and that's the most important thing for me right now, is taking off the mask and seeing me for who God sees me as, and not as who everybody else defined me as, and the lies that I used to believe, because I'm not stupid. I am wonderfully made. And I'm not depressed. And the person out there that hears this, that thinks they're depressed, that they have a mask on, take the mask off. Take the mask off and get down to who you truly are.
So if you're here today and you're struggling with anxiety and depression, do I have amazing news for you? It's amazing news. I have the antidote. And the antidote is truth. And truth isn't ideas or words, it's a person. And his name is Jesus. And he said, I am the way out of the prison that you have built for yourself. And I am the truth in a world filled with lies. And I am the life you've always been looking for. And you say, I want to believe, but I'm having a really hard time. You know the great news about that? Is that you're not the only one who's thought that way. That together we get to believe. This is the power of community. It's why we do what we do. So every week we can be reminded and encourage one another with these words. Christ is risen. He is alive. And in the face of our giants, he is greater. And because he lives, who can stand against me? What can separate me from the love of God? And so when I'm tempted to listen to the lie, that babbling giant spouting hatred and fear, I can look that giant of fear, anxiety, and depression in the face and say, you have no power. You have no power over me. For I serve a God who's greater than you. And I will not allow my life to be dictated by my circumstances. I will allow my life to be directed by a God who made me in his image and has a destiny for me. And we realize that today, for some of you, that's really hard to understand or comprehend. But we just really felt that it was really important that we gave you an opportunity, a moment in time, a crossroads in your life to walk out of the prison cell if you choose to, if you'd like to. For the invitation of Jesus is to all people, no matter what you've done, no matter what your background or where you've come from, no matter what you believe right now, the invitation of Jesus is to all people in all time. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon yourself. Trust me, I will teach you the way. I will show you the way. I will direct you. And so today, if you'd like to receive that, you can. We're going to sing a song over you. And what we mean by that is it's a prayer. And this song is a prayer. And as we sing it, I'm going to give you the opportunity to respond. I've asked Ingrid and Cliff and the prayer team to come to the front. And today, we have time. I'm going to come back and give the blessing. But during this song, this is really your opportunity to decide what you will choose to believe. I hope you choose to believe in Him. For some of you, this will be the first time you've ever done it. If you're watching online, maybe just interact with the online pastor. Just say, hey, I want to make that decision. Or if you're here today, you can make that decision. And here's what we're going to do. If you are here and you want to make that decision, or you're here and you're struggling with fear or anxiety or depression, we just want you to know that you're not alone. And we're going to invite you. Yeah, it's going to be courageous. But facing a giant and seeing God defeat it is courageous. It means taking a step. We're going to invite you just to step out of your seat and come to the front and have someone pray with you to help you understand and believe what is true. And so we believe that this could be a powerful moment in your life. And maybe you're here and you're not ready to make that step, but where you're sitting right now, you want to make that decision. If that's you, I want to just, in this moment, as we sing this song over you, maybe take the connection card and begin to fill it out and say, you know what? I want to make this decision. And if you're here and you're a follower of Christ, but if you're honest, you've allowed the lies to kind of beat you down again, and you need a renewal of faith, of belief, just take this moment to sink, let the words sink in and be changed. And so today, I'm going to give you the opportunity to respond by coming forward. And I know your feet will feel like cement, your heart will be pounding, your head will be racing with all these thoughts. Don't go, everyone's going to think this or that. Don't listen to the lies. Come. Come. And receive the hope. For there is an antidote to anxiety and depression. And it's the truth. And the truth has a name. His name is Jesus.
When day breeds trouble, then you'll hold my
So God, I just thank you for what you're doing in this place. It's beautiful. It's powerful. So just ask that you'd help us to hold on to the truth. When the enemy, the lie, stands on the battleground and taunts us and mocks us and ridicules us. When the giant lie tries to put us into a cage and keep us a prisoner there. Remind us that you are the way out. That you are the victory that we need. And that your truth defeats the lies. And so teach us, Father, what it means to live in your truth every moment of every day and find our freedom there. And I just pray for those who are struggling with anxiety and depression that, God, you would penetrate through the darkness of the lie and reveal your beauty and your power and your love, that when circumstances in this life do not go the way we wanted or hoped, God, you are able to navigate with us through those times and remind us that all things work together for good. That we are not defined by our circumstance, but by the God who made us in his image. And yes, it's true, this world is broken, but you are the healer. And so we trust you. We trust you. And so if you're here today, I want you to know the prayer team is going to stay for a while. Maybe you're here and you're like, "How? Where do I find these truth statements?" We have a piece of paper with some scripture on it that are true statements that you're welcome to come and get after the service. Or if you're in a hurry today, you can just fill out a connection card and let us know and we'll send that to you. Or if you have a Bible, I'd really encourage you, maybe just start in the book of Psalms and start reading. If you don't have a Bible, we'd love to give you one today. If you're watching online and you need a Bible, just let us know. We'll get you one. Because we believe that this is the antidote. This is the truth. And so may you live in the truth today. And we just come against the lie that would try to destroy you and speak to the fact that there's a God who's greater than that lie. So walk in victory, walk in peace, walk in hope, and remember that the light is always brightest in the darkest hour. So live in the light. Do not be consumed by the darkness. And this is why Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." So go in peace, go in victory, go in hope. I bless you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen.